we'll call this IID board meeting on February the 19th, 2013 to order.
At 1:15 in the afternoon. Would you please stand and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance?
Please stand.
Ready?
And begin.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Mr. Taylor, do we have any actions taken in closed session to report out?
Yes, President Desert. In connection with item 4 on the closed session agenda, the board provided direction to its real estate negotiators with respect to the potential purchase of certain tax defaulted properties within the County of Imperial. And in connection with item 5 on the closed session agenda, the board authorized payment subject to certain conditions of a land use application fee to the Torres Martinez tribe.
Thank you, Mr. Taylor. Board, would you please join me in front of the dais to participate in some presentations and service awards?
For the service awards, they all read the same except with the name and years of service. Since the service award, the certificate of recognition and service pin replica of the district emblem are presented to. This one's presented to Araceli McCollum, meter technician apprentice senior, for 25 years of loyal and faithful service to the Imperial Irrigation District. Sally. Okay, for 25 years of service, Jesus Reynosa, lineman, journeyman in the energy department. For 35 years of service, Jose Ortega, heavy transportation truck driver in the water department. Here to receive a service award, and I didn't call your name. Okay, that ends our service awards. Yes.
Okay, Board, you have the agenda before you. We're looking for an approval of the agenda.
So moved.
I second that.
I think we had a couple of items for discussion on here. So the agenda will stand as presented. We'll be handling one item separately under consent. And that'll be item four, the approval of the 2013 legislative platform. So there'll be two different consent actions taken. So we have a motion and a second. Please vote on approving the agenda. Agenda is approved 5-0. This is a time for public comments here. It's limited to 3 minutes per speaker. If you have a public comment, please come to the podium.
Yeah, good afternoon. My name is Tony Ramos. You know, when I was in the Air Force, they always told us, even when you want to do something that's not appropriate, you begin your best behavior. So I hope that this hat and my presentation here is in my best behavior, okay? Mr. President and board members and public, you know, you guys got to do something about Jeff Garber. I mean, he should be sitting there instead of this young man. I have nothing against this young man, but he should be sitting there. Ever since the new board took over, I think it was some resentment and some attacks against Mr. Garber and Mr. Kelly about them getting released or fired. And I think it's headed that way. Hopefully not, but I see it that way. And I see that man right there, Carl Stills, that is being primed, that is being tested, that is being selected to take over this job. I hope it's not true, but that's my feeling. You know, that's the other side of what you guys may think. And Jeff Garber has been an absolute positive to the IED. He's won court issues, and that's why some of the farmers, I'm not going to say all of them, are against him. And I hope they don't work through you people to get this idea through, because he should be here and the public supports him. And if you listen to the public and the public elected all of you, then you should get what the public wants. Transparency is one of the most important things, Mr. President. And I got a letter here dated Ivy Press 930. 2007, that I think was written by Mr. Kelly. It says the good, the bad, and the uncensored, and it talks about transparency, about videotaping these meetings, about letting the public know because they can't come here. And if you don't mind, Mr. Vance, there's 7 copies, there one for each of you, and then. But it's very important that the public knows where this board is coming from. I feel that the right to be an American, the right to speak publicly, the First Amendment, the Brown Act, all combined together allows for the public, when they can be here, to come forward, and when they cannot here, to be represented and to be told what's going on through videotaping. And I hope that the item in the consent agenda, I can't remember what number it is, about videotaping, has nothing to do with doing away with it. Because if it is, then Mr. Hanks, you were the one that suggested that there wasn't transparency back then when the other members were here. And you pushed for transparency and pushed for openness. And that's what we need. You know, I feel that up to now, I haven't seen that here. there's a lot of issues that are still not resolved, and I want the public to know that you should come to the meetings and talk to your board members, allow them to give you feedback on what they're doing, because if you don't do it, nobody's going to do it. I want to close by thanking the public and the board, and advising them to do what's best for the IID, and that's what's best for Ivy First. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Ramos. Any other public comments? Not seeing any. We'll move into board members' comments. We'll start with Director Kuhn.
I have several. I guess our insulation people that were here, are they gone? Mr. Kelly? The people
public benefit.
Yeah, the attic insulation people, they're gone.
Yes.
Okay. I've received a call that somehow there's some kind of pay delay for the people that have had it done, and I would just please ask that we look into that.
Certainly.
And then I received some calls out of Calexico on the senior discount, the energy senior discount, and I guess we don't let them have it unless they're on
the flat plan.
REAP.
The flat plan.
REAP. Yeah. They,
average bill.
Average bill. Thank you. I was asked if something could be done about that. I don't know. Perhaps we should visit that at another time, please. And then it came to my attention that our public information office is out of La Quinta, and truly, I believe that should be here. I mean, I'm not chastising anyone for whatever it's up, why it's up there. It's just that as one board member, I believe it should be here, as our media outlets are here, and typically the first people they call are people here, and I don't know what the delay time is. Maybe there's not, but I just don't understand why it's in La Quinta when I truly believe it should be here. We can visit that. And then it was brought to my attention by members of the Water Conservation Advisory Board that they made a recommendation that the fallowing program be, I think it was 2 out of 3 years, and then it was changed to, I'm sorry, yeah, 2 out of 3 years, but it was changed to 3 out of 5, and they just felt that, you know, we've asked them to look at these things, give us recommendations, and they just felt that was not too nice. Okay, they felt like they kind of had an end run ran around them, and so I would ask that we look into that also.
Certainly.
Okay, and then my last one is, and I'm not, Jesse, don't you take this personal. But I'm not at all comfortable with these automated gates that we're having. I'm not uncomfortable with automated gates. I'm uncomfortable with the ones we are installing. I still believe there's a problem with them. All I'm hearing out in the field that there's problems with these things, up to and including, yes, they can be set remotely. And yes, they do set themselves remotely if you are on a laptop. But according to what I'm hearing, the Sound Herald then has to drive down and physically make sure it did what it was programmed to do. So if that's the case, we'd be getting by with the old gates, because if he has to go down and to make sure it did what it was supposed to, he could set the old gate or a different kind of gate. And I understand and that Rubicon has won the bid for the next bunch as low bidder. But if we have a problem with the ones we have now, I seriously want to stop, take a look at this program, take a look at the product we're getting before we throw any more money at it, before we make any more investment in this area. I would like to find out why we're having problems, what we're having, and rectify the problems. And if they can do that, I'm not opposed to automated gates, but I am opposed to ones that are opening on their own, not closing when they're supposed to. When you have to go down and physically check it, you're not supposed to have to do that. And we had automated gates in the past, and they worked very well. But we've gone to this new thing, and I have some grave concerns. I'm done. Thank you.
Thank you, Director Kuhn. Director Hanks.
You know, last week, there was a group of us that attended the Colorado River Board meeting. And just let everyone be aware that the Upper Basin states are still making noise about how much ag water is available. They still believe in times of shortages, 1 million acre feet available. When they talk about ag water, I think that's code for Imperial Irrigation District. I was also relieved, though, to hear a pretty positive discussion on the inadvertent overrun payback policy. Bart Fisher led the charge on that. That's a California issue. It should be handled within the confines of the California users, because we're still meeting our 4.4 plan. Seems to be a lot of eyes from the Upper Basin states still looking upon us, and I just want to send that out. There's undoubtedly underneath it all, there's a desire of the Upper Basin states to renegotiate the compact, and I think we have to fight that every inch of the way. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Director Hanks. Director Benson.
Hi, everyone. Went to my first Colorado River board meeting. It was interesting. Sat in the back. It's nice to sit in the back and not have to be at the front table once in a while. Tomorrow actually is the Water Conservation Committee meeting. And I just wanted to clarify a time, if it's at 1 o'clock or 12 o'clock.
It's at
1 o'clock. Okay. And then this Friday, Manuel Perez, our assemblyman, is in Mecca at the North Shore Community Center. From 1 to 4, he's hearing comments about the Salton Sea. I invite people to come and speak with him. Also, next Monday, I'm going to be up in Sacramento at the California Farm Water Alliance meeting, and then headed to D.C. with Jim for the AQUA. That's the California Water Association legislative trip. So we're going to go and meet with Interior and a few other people and talk about issues back in D.C. And if anyone has a double extra large jacket, I want to borrow it. One other thing that Bruce brought up, System Conservation Subcommittee, if we could get the message to the WCAB that they could get that restarted, a subcommittee on system conservation to look at these automated gates. And it's come to my attention that there's a strong interest to look at Highline, East Highline, potential lining project, and just ranking from their perspective what good projects would be. I get feedback from a lot of people that they don't support midline laterals. They do support midline laterals. They don't support gates. They do support gates. And I would like to get some recommendations out of that group beyond just what we give them, but kind of they can set up a ranking system. I'd like to see how they do it. Other than that, there's a lot on the agenda, so on to...
Thank you, Director Benson. Director Galindo.
Good afternoon, everyone. Last Thursday, the 14th of February, I attended the Coachella Valley Conservation Commission meetings and the Energy and Environmental Resources Committee in place of Director Desert. It was very, very nice meeting all the mayors of the southern Riverside County area, and it was very refreshing to see them welcome IID as not only as a voting member of these committees, but as being very participatory in the things that are going on in that part of their county. This Saturday, there is going to be an environmental issues workshop in Coachella, and I plan to attend. It is primarily to educate the community with regards to issues of the Salton Sea. I do not know what else to expect, but I do plan to go up there and meet some of the residents of that area. And that's all I have for today. Thank you.
Thank you, Director Glindo. Also, thank you for making that representation of the ID in Coachella last week. Last week, I traveled up to Sacramento with our government affairs person, Antonio Ortega, to attend some events with our lobbyist firm up there, the Gualco Group. And we had some great meetings and time spent with the following assemblymen. It was Manuel Perez, Ben Hueso, Stephen Bradford, Rudy Salas, Ian Calderon, and Senators Rod White, Ron Calderon, Anthony Canella, as well as the state governor's office, Michael Picker, representation on energy issues. So, Antonio, thank you for your work with the IID, and your presence up there is well known. Everyone seemed to know you well, everyone in the hallways as we were walking around and making the rounds. And it was a good meeting. We have good representation with the Gualco Group. And it was a real eye-opener. We met some senators and assemblymen that can perhaps work with us on some local issues we have going on with Torres Martinez Indian tribe, as well as some other activities that we're looking at for funding possibilities for a QSA solution. So it was a very positive event, and thank you again, Antonio, for your work at the IID. Moving on now to the general manager comments, Kevin.
Yes, President Desert, members of the board, today IID filed a request for stay in the QSA coordinated cases with Judge Connolly. That stay request is based on IID's and the and Imperial County's belief that with additional time, 90 days, both agencies are of the opinion that they could come to some resolution of their dispute in the QSA cases. That stay request by IID has been filed with the court. We expect that that Imperial County's joiner in that stay request has also been timely filed, and we will keep the board abreast of any developments connected with that. That's all I have.
Thank you, Mr. Kelly. Mr. Taylor, we have any comments from the...
No, Mr. People? President.
Okay, very good. So we'll move into the consent area of the agenda. There's 10 items in the consent agenda. We're gonna deal with the one item separately. That's item 4. So the first items for looking for consent are the following. Is the approval of the regular board meeting minutes of February 5th, 2013. Payment of the 2013 dues to the Large Public Power Council, the California Farm Water Coalition, the Association of California Water Agencies, and the Water Education Foundation. Item 3 is the continued funding for the UC Desert Research and Extension Center's Farm Smart Program. Item 5, adoption of amended Appendix A1 to the IID Conflict of Interest Code. Item 6, authorization for general manager to sign letter in support of the Water Smart Grant application for pilot salinity gradient solar pond projects. Item 7, approval of additional expenses related to the purchase of certain vehicles on January 8th, 2013 due to tax increases. Items 8, adoption of resolution declaring a number of transformers and miscellaneous items as surplus to the district's operations. Item 9, approval to issue purchase order to Sun Road Auto LLC for the purchase of 4 vehicles. And item 10, acknowledge receipt of wire transfers, cash warrants report for January 2013. So those items mentioned there, we're looking for a motion and a second.
I'll make a motion, but to number 21, just in addition, the when I asked for an audit off schedule, I asked for QSA litigation expenditures from insurance. So it wasn't just litigation, it was also the insurance.
Which item was that, Director Benson?
Number 21 on the minutes.
Oh. Okay. So you have a correction to the minutes.
Correction to the minutes, yeah. Sorry. All right. Thanks.
So we're looking for a motion to the... Any other corrections to the minutes? Director Hanks? Director Kuhn?
I wasn't there, so...
Okay. So we're looking for a motion to accept the items as presented, including the minutes as amended by Director Benson. Is there a motion?
Yeah, you have that motion.
A motion, from Director Benson.
You have a motion second both over there.
In a second?
I can't second my own motion.
I second that.
Director Glendo seconded it. Any other discussion? Call for the vote. Okay, those items pass 5-0. The separate item that we're going to be dealing with in the consent calendar here is the approval of the 2013 legislative platform. Looking for a motion to approve the 2013 legislative platform.
I'll make a motion to approve.
We have a motion from Director Benson, and I'll second that motion. Any other discussion?
Which number are you on?
Item 4 in the consent. We're dealing with it separately.
Oh, you're dealing with that now?
Yes.
Oh, I thought we were going to deal with it down here.
Oh, after information.
It would actually be best if you did it when you've completed the action portion. We do have some additional reporting to do on that
okay,
item.
Okay, then we'll handle that, Antonio, when we deal with the action item. Okay.
Up, down.
This takes us into the information section of the agenda. And we have information item 11, page 77 of your agenda, discussion on videotaping of IID board meetings. Director Kuhn has asked this item to be on the agenda. You want to open the discussion here, Mr. Kuhn?
Thank you. No, just plainly put, it's become quite evident that people come up here and play to the cameras. I mean, we've had some Academy Award nominees that have come up here, and it gets really old really fast. And some of them are just crude. There is an alternative. It's substantially cheaper. And you can go video or you can go just audio as the county's audio. And it's fine. I mean, it's archived. If you want to hear it, you can go listen to it. You just don't have people up there making a mockery of the system. And that has happened here more than once. That said, if anyone's interested, Granicus, Granicus, at granicus.com. They're approximately $10,000 a year. I think we're up around $100,000. And so we could get this basically, well, I believe this is a superior product. And we could save $90,000 a year. And we could go audio. And perhaps those that come up here who are auditioning for higher films or, you know, get off the B list would maybe go somewhere else. And that would just suit me fine. But meantime, we can save $90,000 a year by going with somebody else anyway.
The name of that service provider is Granicus.
Granicus.
Once again. Well, thank you, Director Kuhn, for bringing that forward. I think we should take a look at all opportunities that we have available to us. Mr. Kelly, do we know how much longer the current contract is good for?
Yeah, you're in the third year, and I believe it runs through the rest of 2013.
Okay. Well, I'm interested in taking a look at this, Mr. Kuhn.
I mean,
is that live?
Yeah.
Production.
I have a comment on this also. I called Granicus after I was placed on the board because I had heard about it from city councils in the county as well. They currently do MWD's meetings as well, so you could watch their meetings live. It's a great place to go watch them. But they are coming down here on Friday to meet with the communications group, We've been in contact with them.
Oh, wow.
And it's more of an informal meeting to find out what their system is, and they wanted to investigate just what we had. But we could stream those so people don't have to sit through the meetings. And the other thing was staff. We might have a place set up so staff could sit and do their work and don't have to sit in the audience through a whole meeting, and they can come in when it's their time.
Well, as I understand it, you can actually get it on your cell phone also.
Probably.
I am aware that meeting's scheduled with Granicus. I recall Granicus actually responding when the original RFP was issued for broadcasting IID meetings. The only proviso that I would leave with the board is that I'm constantly amazed at the number of people who watch IID meetings on that fixed channel, that public access channel on the cable system. And I think it does add some expense to the contract that you could avoid. But I do want the board to just be cognizant of the fact that there are a number of insomniacs who watch
I took it a step further. I said, if you watch this stuff on television, you need to get a life.
I just like to make a comment, and I'm probably dissenting opinion or my minority opinion or whatever, particularly on the part of public comments. You know, I've been a recipient of a lot of public comments, and may not necessarily appreciate or enjoy it, or but I do know that's a right of the public to make comments. I also very familiar with the Baca versus Moreno Valley School District court case. Mr. Baca came to Calipat Unified School District when I was a superintendent, and I was on the receiving end of some of his tirades. And I learned real quick what the law was. Hopefully, we get to a point, we may always have dissenting opinions, but hopefully we keep working and moving the IID to where that becomes minimal. But I will defend that right. People say what they have that right to speak at public comments. They are responsible for what they say, but they do have that right, and I'll defend it.
I have no problem with them coming to these meetings talking. I haven't just...
Yeah, I just don't, you know, if you don't want to show that part, that's would be up to you guys. But I want to be careful how we handle that. I might sleep better at nights if we did, but yeah.
All right. I didn't have any problem with the video portion. It was just in order to stream it live. That was the thing that I was going after.
Mr. Ramos.
Yes, you know, I heard that Mr. Kuhn was the one that suggested this, and yet Mr. Kuhn stood here before the election and called my compadre a cockroach. You know, he said that my compadre defecated in the middle of a motel. He said all kinds of ugly things. And he's got the gall to not say who he's talking about, and yet he's the one that he's talking about himself. You know, don't listen to this guy. You know, he's the one that approved the QSA and now is fighting to bust it, along with Ivy First. And people, this guy right here lost for several years until Ivy First, with her $1 million budget, put him in the office. And it was the Abadis, Mike Morgan sitting over there, and Big Bucks that got him in. It wasn't his money. He said he never knew people in Ivy First, and he dines and wines with them. So for me to hear what he's saying, don't get involved with them, the other four people. Talking about whatever we say, it's freedom. Freedom of speech, First Amendment rights, the Brown Act. There's nothing wrong with it. You know, you've already taken away 5 minutes or 3 minutes. You've already taken away meetings at the Quinta meetings here. And to do this, it's something, it's a wish on by him. It's nothing else. You know, and he sits there acting like he doesn't know what he's doing. He knows exactly what he's doing. And you, Matt, and Mr. Galindo, I praise you for, even we agree sometimes, for speaking out at the Ivy board meetings. And even you, Mr. Benson, we've had differences. This guy, he's going to get you guys in trouble. The public has a right to see and hear what the public wants, and there's nothing wrong with it. If I came
it's
just, here,
it's just another alternative to videotaping. It would still be covered.
Yeah,
Mr. Ramos.
Yeah, but what I'm trying to say, don't change anything the way it is right now. The videotaping, the audio, the video, stay, keep it that way. There's no reason to change it. You know, the truth may hurt, but no. There's an old Spanish saying in the Mexican community, "La verdad no duele, pero incomoda," which means that the truth may hurt, but it makes you feel uncomfortable. You know, and that's the way it is. I've had run-ins with Mr. Kuhn before, and we still at least respect each other. We're never going to end up throwing blows because I'm not that kind of guy, and he's bigger than me, so he'll probably kick my butt. But the thing is, it's neither here nor there. You know, there's an old saying on Karl Rove when he was helping elect President Bush. He was a genius, you know, and they called him a genius because he was able to get him elected 2 terms. But one term I remember it said, "For whom the gods will destroy, they first make famous." And the plural is gods, the gods of political power, the god of money, the god of being envious, the god of this and that. And if you don't have a god that's just one god, you're going to be destroyed. So don't join this guy.
Okay.
And be careful, Matt. I'm telling you, and he's probably talking about me when he says that, at least that I come here. I don't come here to pawn my back. Or I come here to help the people that are not here to help themselves. That's all I'm doing. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Ramos.
Yeah, I'm not opposed to taking a look at this. You know, there is a big difference. But we need, as you said, Mr. Keller, we need to weigh the benefits. Where will it serve the people the best? But I would also like to, on the other side of the coin, this could be seen in Calipatin Island, whereas currently the videos are not available to them that we currently have. Thank you.
Mr. Ramos, I would just like to set the record straight. I didn't say I wanted it shut off. I want to look at a different style, and it would be audio, or it could be video if the others choose. I don't care. But I just want to make this perfectly clear also. The first check I received when I got back on this board, nearly 100% of it went to pay an electric bill for a young woman with 7 children who had her power cut off. And so if you think I don't care about this community, you're just full of crap.
Thank you. That's okay. What 2 people full of crap meant.
All right, well, let's move on. Mr. Almeta.
Thank you.
I just have a comment. How you doing? Fernando Zavala, Spectrum Advertising. Just to answer one of your cases, Mr. Benson, we are capable of doing live streaming.
Okay.
As a matter of fact, we did a test, and we would love to talk to you about, once the contract is due and revising it. One of the things that we looked into is obviously go live, and that was previously discussed on the previous board when it was approved. So even if a price is an issue, Mr. Kuhn, we can certainly address that if you need more information from us. But live video is one of the capabilities, of course. And just to touch on that Granicus contract, Mr. Kuhn, there is more information when it comes to that as far as the price goes. I encourage you to visit that before you make a decision, sir.
It sounds to me like they've already set up something. I was not aware of it. So
thank you. So anything
I
else
look forward to hearing
can
from
do, we can surely help. And as far as La Quinta, your ACAC meetings are videotaped at Time Warner Cable up there every Monday at 8:30. So FYI, your meetings are also viewed up there.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. Mr.
President, excuse me, I want to thank you for your indulgence.
Okay, we'll move on to item 12 under information, review of recommendations and responses to audit of Western Farmlands, page 78 of the agenda.
Good afternoon, directors. My name is Shane Ferber, Assistant Supervisor of the Real Estate. Today I'm here to present the Western Farmlands Land Lease Application Review. On August 6, 2012, the internal auditors reviewed the Western Farmlands Land Lease Real Estate Application and evaluated the reports and the way that the database was used to store information. The audit recommendations were as follows. Staff should maintain only one comprehensive database of all leased parcels, including lease lessee identification and payments received. Number two, the Western farmland leases should be specifically identified with a prefix attached to its lease ID, such as Western Farmlands. Number three, historical ranch names should not be used to identify fields when communicating with lessees in public for advertising invoicing. And number four, the lease ID assigned to a specific parcel should remain unchanged throughout the tenant's occupancy. As part of the audit recommendations, we have made changes to the database as follows. There's only one database that we're using to manage all property. User customized reports have been developed, and we continue to further refine them to provide specific information requested to various different departments. Number two, a new column has been identified to these reports to identify how the lease properties or the owned properties are stored. These properties are identified as a type in the sample table that's shown. Historical ranch names have been eliminated from reports, and we either use Canal and Gate or APN depending on the report. And typically for all reports, we order the data by Canal and Gate and show the property status as leased, unsold, or unleased. This approach effectively addresses the underlying concern, which is to identify the status of the land. And the only time a new lease ID is changed is when a new lease is written. Are there any questions?
So it's all together now in one database that you're working with and tracking?
Yes.
And how long has it been in the one database?
For all Western Farmlands leases, they were always in one database, but we've been continually modifying the reports and adding additional information with the consulting staff in the IT department.
And any other farmland that the ID has that's in a separate database from the Western Farmlands?
That's how it was done historically.
So now they're all in one?
We're working to combine everything.
Thank you. Information item 13, Water Department General Managers. Mr. Silva, page 82 of the agenda.
Good afternoon, Mr. President, board members. Minute 319 is in the process of being implemented. And one of the things that they're doing, they being the International Boundary Water Commission, is forming some technical groups to work on some of those issues that were identified. The one that we're concerned about is the All-American Canal turnout to Mexico. If you remember, that was one of the items that was in the minute. They are forming a technical committee. I've volunteered to be on it. We're supposed to be having the first organizational meeting here the end of the month sometime, and so we need to get back to the board and tell you what's going on. But that has started, and so that's one of the ones that we're interested in. The rest of the committees, we don't really have much to say about it, but this one that we are very interested in. So I will be attending those meetings. President.
Any questions, board?
Yeah, Mr. Silva, in your conversation with them, will you be discussing the capacity issue, time of use, and priority?
All those issues, yes, and the issue of also being part of the pilot program to conserve water, all the other issues that have been identified, yes.
Maybe you can get them to build us an emergency siphon, huh?
Yeah, or some storage at the end or something, yeah. Okay.
Yeah. All right. Thank you.
Jesse, I had a question.
Yes.
On the Western farmlands, Shane brought it up, but fallowing going forward, is it still anticipated that fallowing is going to happen on that farm ground next year, or would that come back to the board?
It will have to come back. I think that discussion is going to take place in the Water Conservation Committee that you're part of. Right. To me, all that needs to be integrated into that decision, so we come back to the full board with a recommendation one way or the other, yes.
And what's the timeline for understanding the payback, as far as we know it's going to happen next year? What's the amount of the payback that we have to come up with next year?
Next year it's going to be about
I think it's 62,000 less, about 50,000 right now.
Yeah, but next year it's the numbers we're paying back. Tina's got the numbers there.
For this calendar year, it's going to be about 62,000 acre feet, less any early payback that we can get credit for that we're working on to get that number. The 2014 requirement will be the 2012 overrun. I think it's going to end up about 150,000 acre feet, plus the balance from 2011, which is about 20,000 acre feet. So my best guess for next year is 170,000.
And as I have alerted the board, I have made the request of the regional director, Terry Fulp, that, you know, in a worst case, IID may be back to the Bureau to ask for some additional time in which to make good on that.
And the number that went out to the Water Conservation Committee was 5.24 acre feet, I think it was, and a potential allocation.
Yes.
I know that was in the paper, but I had a lot of questions back on that. And does that include the payback water, or is that exclude payback water?
No, it does
that
not.
Excludes. It's just a straight allocation, yeah. Just taking the 3.1, deducting all of other requirements, and that's what you end up with, right?
So my understanding was we were trying to get the allocation to count as a conservation measure, potentially with the Bureau. Is
Bureau
that
as well, yeah.
We have asked the Bureau to consider that, and we are amending our payback plan to include that.
So if we do that, would that take that number off the top and have a lower amount of water?
That's probably too good to hope for in the short term. But we did tell the Bureau that we'd be moving ahead of getting an official okay.
All right, because that was based on what, 450,000 acres, más o menos?
Roughly, yes.
So 150, 170 out of that would be 0.3 acre feet,
mm-hmm.
taking us down to 4.9 acre feet per acre?
Yes. It's a big number.
Right. I'm the only farmer on the board, so it affects me more than these guys. And I know that they know it affects them, but we've been looking at our farm ground trying to figure out how to put a farm plan together. And the sooner we come up with a an allocation or not allocation, it affects what we're planting going forward. So appreciate it.
Now, you know, as a matter of fact, for tomorrow's committee meeting, I think both the president and vice president are going to be, for some amount of time, you will be unable to attend because you'll be with the commissioner. It would probably be helpful if you would sit in and run that meeting tomorrow.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you, Jesse.
Thank you.
Next item under information is item 14, is update by Al Kalin on the Water Conservation Advisory Board issues discussed at its February 14th, 2013 meeting, page 83 of the agenda.
Mr. Good Kalin. Afternoon. Al Kalin, Westmoreland. Knowing I was going to be videotaped, I had my hair done today. I put the wind, the wind blew it all away, and it's all messed up. So I apologize for it being in disarray. WCAB minutes of our February 14th meeting. We welcome Manuel Castro. Manuel was appointed by Director Benson and assumed the vacancy created when Ryan Mamer resigned from the board. Under public comment, Mr. Abadi stated that, Jim Abadi stated that they're in the process of updating the WCAB fallowing program. It's a subcommittee that's working on that. Monthly division updates by Kerry Stage and Mike Pacheco. They reported that on that day, the IID was delivering 3,010 cubic feet per second, which included 135 separate 12-hour runs. WCAB member Larry Cox questioned Mr. Silva about IID reservoirs and how they were used. Mr. Silva stated the reservoirs were being used to distribute water in the morning so they could be as low as possible in the afternoon to accept AM runs being shut off. There was discussion about the possibility of a crop water use estimate being developed due to the looming water apportionment. Mr. Silva offered to have IID staff work on a draft forecast by crop use. While IID's existing software doesn't include a crop planning module, Mr. Fillmore said he would explore usable options within the IID's computer software system. It was discussed that water use for most crops remains constant, as does the acreage grown from year to year, with small incremental changes, but wheat and particularly Sudan grass acreage can vary drastically from year to year depending on commodity prices and have a large impact on water use. Mitigation water runs in 2013, there was a handout that we received as part of the information Mr. Silva gave us, I thought was very interesting, about the water that's released to go into the Salton Sea. 70,000 acre feet is required for 2013, and the handout stated that not more than 300 cubic feet per second would be dumped in the New or Alamo River at any one time to stop any flooding that might happen. I assume you'll get that same handout, and I think it's very interesting. The 12-hour run subcommittee report, they're continuing to work on methods of saving more water by balancing the excessive number of AM runs with the low number of PM runs. IID legal counsel Joanna Smith is investigating the legalities of creating a different price structure for use of AM and PM water, if that might work. It was discussed that more flexibility is needed to balance the AM and PM orders. Better communications between the growers and IID staff, and an increase in number of San Jeros to handle excess number of AM orders ending in the afternoon. And I might state that, as I remember it, during the time Jim Ross was the water manager, he reduced the number of San Jeros. Looking back, that was probably a poor move, and I really think it needs to be rectified to manage the water better. When you look at the cost of the San Jero, that might be your best bang for the buck. I mean, I was told one time that and I'm not sure if this is correct, but I was told the Rubicon Gate cost $80,000. I think that's about what a San Jero costs a year. You know, there's other things that I think could be cut to save money to pay for more San Jeros, but I think it's very important that you, the board, look at that carefully, see if we can get more San Jeros on board. They've done studies in the past in the North End, and in areas where there was excessive AM runs and no PM runs, and they put extra San Jeros on for a short period of time. It was found that they were able to balance that high and low. So it proved that it really worked to have more on duty when they were needed. The IID Water Conservation Subcommittee update was given by Jesse Silva. He provided four handouts, communication plan for apportionment program, the IID Water Conservation Committee resolution, summary of mitigation water in 2013 and the mitigation water in 2013, and discuss the information. I assume he'll be furnishing you with that same information. The on-farm water conservation subcommittee, there's a technical review committee that is looking at what can be done. In other words, if you're going to have on-farm conservation, you have to have a technical review committee to look at situations where a farmer doesn't agree with what IID says, so we can go kind of appeal it more or less to the a committee, and they can make a decision. So that's being looked at. Darren Fillmore briefed the WCB on subcommittee's work and how a technical review committee might operate. WCAB will study a furnished handout and address the subject during a future meetings. We also had a report on solar field temporary fallowing update by David Bradshaw at WCAB's request last month. Mr. Bradshaw gave a presentation of the temporary land conversion, and the presentation was discussed. Mr. Bradshaw also reported on the regular fallowing program update. He said that the 2013-2014 solicitation letters would be mailed out very soon. Our next meeting is March 14th. We hope all of you can come. We intend to discuss a breakdown of all transferred water and the average amount of money each one generates, the crop acreage estimates and estimated water usage using average used for each crop. There'll be a 12-hour run subcommittee update. We'll discuss incentives for use and PM runs. And finally, we'll have an update on the on-farm water conservation. And that's about it. Any questions?
Questions, board? Thank you, Al.
Thank you.
Al, I had a question. I'm sorry, but in talking about the system conservation and looking at the gates, have they looked at the gates before at WCAB?
Yes. We had a subcommittee to look at, in particular, Vail. Gates, and right after that, I was removed from the WCAB board, so that didn't go very far, but I'll be glad to start up again.
Okay.
Al, before you sit down, if you looked at them, are we still talking about the same automated gates? What was the conclusion then?
They weren't working.
Okay.
Okay, up is the information item 15 is the review of amendment number 6 to service agreement number 81935 for PSK Solutions. Mr. Villione presenting.
Good afternoon, Director Desert and Board of Directors. Carlos Villione from Water Department. This is a third year of a three-year plan for transitioning from Ms. Kosciuszko's support of the WIS system to IT. There are various activities that IT has conducted, including they're right in the middle of upgrading the server operating system, and the they're going to be upgrading and are upgrading the Oracle database version to the newer version. Separate from that, what we've been doing is meeting between Water Department staff and IT staff, have identified key Water Department people that work in the various modules that were at this particular meeting, so that we make sure that everybody understands that we have this year to have IT fully supported the Water Department, but as well to have the key users given proper tools so that they provide support for their users, as well as coordinating with IT in case there's anything, any special needs, special data requests, so that we can take over the system. We're going to come back in a couple of weeks to ask for the renewal for this year of PSK Solutions service agreement.
Okay, any questions, board, for Carlos?
Carlos, who is the staff that works on the WIS?
We have various, for instance, in my area, the control and monitoring group, we have SCADA and monitoring supervisors, along with a couple of operations analysts that work in those areas. We have some planning staff that work on the fallowing program, the Safe Drinking Water Act program, and the general quality control for all the operations data that's captured in the system. So there's a variety of staff working within the various modules that have grown over the last 15, 16 years that the WIS has evolved. It even has a module for land trust. The database that was originally set up was for the trust lands that were bought. And that program was literally just a migration of a database that was an Excel spreadsheet that was used by the couple that was managing the land trust at the time. There was no additional functionality added, just a spreadsheet that was migrated into the database system. But there's other functionality that has evolved through the years that we need to look at to see if it should stay in the WIS or we should get some commercially available software like land management.
So when Darren's looking up the on-farm conservation numbers for specific fields and crops, is that in the WIS?
It's in the WIS, yes.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
This PSK solution, that's the Penny Kosciuszko?
That's one consultant. That's correct.
And like, I don't know, 10, 12 years ago, I guess, I had issues with this contract. It was substantially smaller than it is now, but I was told, I hope rightfully so, that, and it says here, MWD picks up most of this?
No, they only pick up the water verification data module. That's out of the $224,000 for this service agreement, I think their share is $40,000. So it's 50% for the water verification module.
Okay. My issue with it back in time was that, and I tried to get us to teach one of our people to do this so we didn't have to continue this. And I actually tried to stop this, like I said, about 12, 13 years ago.
We're still trying.
But what was the young man from MWD that started working for us? Kurt Dimmitt? Okay, he was working for Met at the time, and he told me that, no, before you do anything with her, we really need her. And so Met picked up half of the cost. Apparently, those costs have migrated back to us again. Now, of her whole, of the whole contract, what are we paying? The entire contract.
Out of the 224, ID pays $184,000.
Oh, yeah, they've migrated back big time. I'm not trying to be oversimplistic here, but you know, I was told a long time ago that cemeteries are full of people we can't do without. But you know, if someone dies, we have to replace them. We don't shut the place down, or if they retire and quit. One day she's going to retire, and we're still going to have someone take over. I mean, what do we do here? This is still here. And this is almost like a soap opera. You know, I'm gone for 8 years, you turn it back on, it's the same people doing the same thing and nothing's changed. What does it take? I'm not putting you on the spot, Carl.
I understand that.
Yeah. But dang, this is expensive. Very expensive. And it's, again, I was assured that Met was paying half of it. Now here we are, you know, 10, 12 years later, and the lion's share of the cost of this thing is back on us. I don't get it. And you've been trying to get rid of this for a while?
Yeah. Mr. Alegranza.
Well.
Do you have staff members that are going to be able to take this function over?
And I'm not knocking her work. I think she does good work. I have no complaints with it. I don't want to be mischaracterized like I was a while ago. I do care. But I was assured that Met was taking half of us, it was okay, it didn't matter. And then I said, well, okay, if they're paying half of it, it's fine. But again, here we are, down the road, and I know people aren't supposed to come back to this board, but you know, with the help of some multi-gazillionaires that I really don't know, I'm back. But it's still going on, and it's been going on a long time.
Mr. Alexander, would you introduce yourself, please?
Tony Alegranza, the interim CIO for the IID. To answer your question, we will be doing a further assessment on what it takes to support the WIS system. We do have staff right now. We're supposed to be, we want to be done this year with the documenting the processes so we can internalize that. Like Mr. Villon has said, it takes a staff in the water department to actually run the application. The IT portion will be doing the server support, the database support, and the programming. So I can't give you a 100% answer right now, but that is the goal, is to internalize the process completely.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, sir.
Any other questions?
Thank you, Carlos.
No, I guess we'll be here in 4 years.
They're going to outlive us.
Just nothing changes.
Okay, next up we have information item 16. The Chief Financial Officer will provide an overview of the Water Department 2013 proposed budget, page 89.
Good afternoon. This is an update from our December 18th presentation to highlight some changes. They are pretty minor since our last budget. I will point out that there have been some reorganization changes in the organization that are not reflected in these changes, but they will be in the final budget that we present to the board in probably middle of March. So summary of changes, we've broken down in three main categories, revenues, operations and maintenance, and capital. And as you can see, there's been a slight increase in revenues. And on a further slide, I'll go into this in a little more detail. About $500,000 increase in revenue, a slight increase in O&M expense, and some increases in capital of about $250,000. The summary, revenues increased by $462,000, expenses by $86,000. The revenue increase is really by two main reasons. One, the other agency revenues, we're getting some additional money from the All-American Canal project. And then dropping down to the third bullet, there's an increase in MET expenditures, which results in a corresponding increase in MET revenues. So those are the two main components of the $462,000 increase. The decrease in O&M is caused mainly by the decrease in the support services budget. That is going down by about 5%, and that filters through to the water department and reduced cost. And then there's a slight increase in debt service, where we're continuing to lease some equipment for this next year. And then the capital plan increased by $253,000. One of the items causing that is the All-American Canal Lining Project didn't get completed in 2012. That's being rolled over to 2013. And then the Water Department picks up some expenses for support services, the modular building, joint vehicles, and the web EOC project. And then the next three slides, we've broken down the O&M budget in a little more detail to highlight where those expenses are going. This first slide is what I call the Water Department O&M excluding ANG cost. And as you can see, it's engineering services, maintenance, operations, system controls, and ag water management. And since the last time we've been in front of the board, those costs have decreased to $133,000. And then the what we call other O&M, which we present monthly on our financial statements, it includes allocated G&A, some contingencies on uncollectible accounts, and those dollars did not change since the last presentation. Debt increased slightly, $114,000. Again, that's from some equipment we're going to continue to lease in 2013.
What's the percent of G&A that's allocated? Do you know? Is it 50 or less than 50?
That I don't know. We'll have to look at that and get back to you. And this is what we call special O&M, which includes the transfer, the Western farmlands, local entity, MET, et cetera. And those costs have gone up $105,000. I mentioned earlier that the costs from MET are offset by increased revenue. Those expenses are pretty much a pass-through within certain limits. So that was a $100,000 increase since the last presentation.
The water transfer row there, Greg, on the first row?
Yes.
That's specific water transfer money for projects?
That is transfer expenses.
And in the budget, you'll show that itemization for all water transfer proceeds? That'll have a separate tracking method that we can look at?
Yes, it's in the budget book.
Greg, on the overrun paybacks, what were you calculating out an acre foot there?
It's either 125 or 150. I can't remember which.
And how many acre feet was that? Yeah.
It was 60.
60?
It wouldn't be quite 60,000 acre feet, would it?
I think, Greg, that you... you told me that you erred on the cautious side at 150.
Okay.
And that the 60, you'll recall, we believe it's going to be closer to 50.
Okay.
Well, that'd be 7.5 million if it was 150, right?
It would be, and that's why I was hesitating. Tina can help me out here.
I don't remember the actual number, but we do have some ICS credits we're using towards payback, and we had some groundwater storage, so I think that was the estimated use.
It was 43,000 is the, if it's at 125 for fallowing, 43,256.
So if you had a 62,000 acre foot minimum payback reduction, there was about 6,000 acre feet in storage, about 500 acre feet in groundwater storage, and about 10,000 acre feet of excess main canal seepage from last year that we're trying to roll forward to this year.
So that drives
the number 43,000.
Yeah. Ground that's not in the fallowing program.
But they do that.
Yeah. They can't.
And then I'm going to ask Carlos from the Water Department to go over the staffing slides.
If you know that there was $133,000 extra, I believe, from the last presentation, the bulk of that cost is in staff and in the conservation programs, primarily the on-farm activities that are starting off, the on-farm farm unit-based contracts that they're trying to set up. I believe there's also a couple of staff members in the controls group based on the additional field sites and the monitoring sites that are going to be installed, something like an additional 300 sites in this first phase, 196 farm deliveries, 22 headings, 96 additional spills. And that's the bulk of the change, the being driven by the water conservation program.
Carlos, again, that increase in staffing is primarily water conservation, on-farm conservation?
Water conservation and a little bit of system conservation.
So where do the Sanjeros fall in?
There are no additional Sanjeros, but they are under south end and north end,
okay.
O&M at the very bottom. It's approximately 62 Sanjeros on the north end and... in the north end, south end, and 50.
So that's water control and that's no, not water control.
No. North end and south end divisions, that's where the Sanjeros are scheduled out of and supervised.
Where's the water control person?
They are in AAC Dam and O&M.
Okay.
We basically have two dispatching offices, one here in Water, in Imperial for the main canals, and the control house at Imperial Dam itself.
Okay.
Are you going to show us in the budgeting process somewhere along the way which ones are charged off to the transfer funds and which ones are charged off to the water department?
Yeah, the next three slides will show that. So as you can see, there's some employees will be charging or forecasting 100% of their time to the transfer, and some only a portion of their time, either one quarter or three quarters. So I can run through these three slides, and I'll go back to the first one to give you an example of all the various types of positions that are budgeted to be charging the transfer and the program they'll be working on, and whether they're full or part-time. And that's the third slide. And if you add it all up, it's a little over 38 full-time equivalents charging the transfer.
And when you say transfer, you're also talking Met 1.
Yes, that's included in there too.
What is SCP?
I believe that's System Conservation Programs.
So there, if it says SCP, that's what it is, but it's actually water transfers out of the QSA, out of the San Diego transfer.
Yes, that is the
creating water transfer.
Transfer.
So. And there's 10 San Harrow positions paid for out of the Met 1 water transfer.
Yes.
I think those are to run the 12-hour runs, right?
That's stupid.
Hey, you want to open up for comment?
Any further questions, board? Public comment, please. Mr. Morgan.
Mike Morgan, Brawley, California. I just emailed everyone but Jim, because I don't have his email, the PSK, the minutes from the PSK meeting February last year. I recommend you go through it, because I think it is time to probably cut that off. Like Bruce says, it goes on and on and on. One question on this engineering, on this budget number of 18, is that 18 in-house engineers? Does anybody know it's on engineering services, 2.8 million, and then I thought I saw engineering services, 28 employees. Is that in-house engineering services?
Yeah, that the bulk of the engineering staff is in water engineering section, but there are also some in the planning group. So they're kind of spread out.
It, at $75 an hour, your outside engineering bill looks like 19 full-time engineers on the outside at $75 an hour. So I don't know what the outside numbers are. 2.8 million, I don't know who it's spread over, but Keller Blisner, I think, has three engineers or four, and David's Engineering has maybe six or eight. So it looks like, if other than you having more engineering firms than that, which I'm sure you do, you're using well over 100% of their time. So I would hope you'd look at that, because if you have 18 full-time engineering type people in your agency and this is no reflection on Carlos or anybody else, but you need a chief engineer that's managing them, because that, in my mind, would take care of all your stuff in-house and give you really, really good quality homegrown intelligence versus 2.8 to outside engineers. And again, I don't know if they're PSK type engineers, or I don't know if they're hardcore physical engineers. So I think I'd look into that in your budget. I wouldn't go over it that quickly.
Thank you, Mr. Morgan. Any other comments or questions from the audience? On the staffing question brought up about the engineers, Greg, is that right? That's 18 full time, or is it? Or how are we calculating those? Do we know how we break them out by hour? Is it 38, 18?
Well, there's 38 for these conservation programs, but any outside contractors are not considered full-time employees, so they won't be in our staffing levels.
So all outside contractors are not broken down in any shape or fashion by employee equivalents?
Well, yeah, they're not by employee, not for our budgeting purposes. Now, the water department may do something internally within the water department, but we don't.
And Greg, could you share with us a little bit more about how the water transfer monies are tracked or recorded in this budget? We've worked at that over the last couple of budget cycles.
Yes, in the budget book, and we're still in the process of revising that, there's, I don't know, 7 or 8 different pages that list various water transfer expenses, and they're lined or expensed separately along with the revenue. We've broken out that and Western Farmland separately from the total water budget.
And the Western Farmland, those are all paid off now, so that's an annual debt service savings of some $6-7 million.
That's correct. The Western Farmland's budget is down considerably since there's no longer any debt service, so there's primarily lease revenue and lease expenses associated with the Western Farm.
And that's a fair range of a number, of accurate number, $6-7 million annual debt service we're saving.
I think we were saving roughly $5 million or so right now, but that would have increased in 2027. It would have gone, I think, even a little higher than $5 million at that point, because there was one last term bond that needed to be paid off.
And is $16 million, $16-17 million, a safe number to say that how much water transfer money we're utilizing within the water budget?
We're allowed to use
25%, and that seems reasonable. I think next year it's around 40. I'm doing this from my head, from memory. It's like 100,000 acre feet, I think, at $490 or $440 an acre foot, which would give you about $44 to $50 million, and 25% of that is in the $13 million range.
So that 25%, that's just what the water department's using from the transfer funds. That doesn't count expenses that are authorized through the water transfers.
That's correct. That's by board action. That's the amount that we can use to support the water department
budget. Yes, above and beyond what the additional expenses have been incurred by the IID because of the water transfer.
The water transfer revenue pays for the water transfer expenses, and then there's additional monies available to use for what I call the water delivery portion of the business.
And that's, so you're expecting that to go down next year?
the what? I'm sorry.
We were talking 16, 17 million this year, and you're anticipating that it'll go down next year?
No, the calculation, the amount that's going to be available will continue to rise based on increased deliveries and increased prices.
Right. But that doesn't necessarily mean we're going to be utilizing all that.
That's correct. That's just the amount that is available if the board so chooses.
Any other questions, board?
I have a question. It relates to the payback for next year. You have the payback for this year. Next year's payback would be over $21 million if we were to use the same rule of thumb of $125. And I don't know where in this budget it would come out of, other than out of the water transfer revenues, I would assume.
It won't be budgeted until 2014 when we have to pay it, and it'll either have to come out of water transfer revenues or reserves.
And what are the reserves? I didn't see them on here, but
I think there's around $90 million of unrestricted water cash.
And then there was another question. I know it was brought up, the rebuilding of the system. There was a study done every 75 years. It's assumed that the canals and upgrades need to be made. I think that estimate was over $1 billion, $1.1 billion, I want to say.
Yeah, it was over $1 billion, yes.
Yeah. So that came out to about $15 million a year. And I was wondering, is that in this budget, or does that start in the future when we have enough reserves to start spending that money? Or what is the plan?
The way it we've modeled it is beginning, I think, in 2019 or 2020, we start replacing the system with transfer monies, basically. And so over the next 75 years, beginning in 2019, we expect the transfer to be able to pay for those improvements or replacements.
Okay.
At that level, at roughly $101.4 billion.
Okay.
Whether that will be enough, we won't know until 75 years from now.
Is there any way, I know that there's a water model that looks at the transfer as a whole. Is there a way to look at the whole department as a whole and kind of look at the flow of projects? And I don't know if the water department has done that, but it seems like we have highs and lows with staff on on-farm conservation, system conservation. And if we're bringing all this staff in, what do we do with them in 5-10 years when we don't have any more projects to put in? It's hard to find places for people here, and unless they all retire at once, I don't know how we can bring those people on and then expect to have a home for them.
Well, the model doesn't have a lot of increase in staff other than this year. I mean, there's most of what has been modeled for the water system conservation projects is by contractors, so that we won't, right now the plan is not to gear up and hire a bunch of people internally to do projects that will only last 5 or 10 years, because like you said, then the question becomes what are they going to work on after that. So that's what the plan is now and what we put into the model.
Okay.
I got. Mr. Morgan, you have another comment?
Well, I'm confused. Maybe Greg can help me on this. 2 or 3 months ago, we saw a report on water transfer income of $70 million, and out of that, $50 million was disappearing or was being spent. Am I confused about that? We came over the Farm Bureau, and you shared this pie chart. It was a whole different number than what we're hearing today. And on the side, bring on some young people and then let attrition take care of the other people that go out after 7 years when you don't have them. As long as you use outside consultants, you got to remember Peggy at PSK was your employee. She got bought out very nicely from her contract and then went to another job. And her cohort, Brad Thornson, went on to your engineer, David's Engineering, who is now one of your prime engineers on your outside. But was I right about that 50 or 70 million?
She's not here anymore?
She was on Alpine. She contracts.
There's an IID early in your budget process. There's a deal you put out that said you were receiving $70 million in water transfer and $50 million was going someplace. We asked if they could tell us where it was going. They said no, SAP doesn't have fund accounting. But you can do your own math. You have Tina gave you a number for fallowed acres or fallowing acre feet. You can come up with a rough number on what that's costing you. The rest of it, I don't know where it's going.
Mr. Kelly, is there any way we could get a breakdown where this money is going?
We have done that. We'll do it again. I think I do recall that. I don't want to misspeak, but I think it was $73 million in revenue attributed to the water transfer. That ring a bell?
It's probably the water transfer and MET and maybe a couple of other sources.
Yeah, we'll provide that to you.
If you have done in the past, I would really like a breakdown bring myself up to speed.
Okay. Any other questions for Greg? Thank you, Greg. Next item is information item 17, salt and sea mitigation water alternatives presented by the Chief Financial Officer, Mr. Broeking. Page 95 of the agenda.
I think at the last board meeting, Director Benson asked us to look at the water alternatives, and that's what we've done. We have what we call the base case and two alternatives, and want to show the impact, the financial impact on all three of those scenarios. So the first one is what we call the base case. That's where we're transferring 480,000 acre feet of water between 2014 and 2017. And this is just what we use for modeling purposes. We've had the cost at fallowing cost at $150 an acre foot. We know by contract that we'll receive an average price of a little over $128 an acre foot for that water. And that's currently what we have modeled. And then we came up with scenario one, where there would be no mitigation water into the sea for those 4 years. So if that's the case, there would be no fallowing cost incurred. The JPA does not pay IID for the mitigation water. However, IID's contributions to the JPA continue. We'll still be required to make our contributions of about $61 million. And then under this scenario, the water that was not followed, we just sold at the agricultural water rate of $20 an acre foot. So that was alternative scenario one. And alternative scenario two is what's in front of the state board, where there will be 160,000 acre feet of mitigation water sold over the next 4 years. We used the same fallowing cost of $150 an acre foot. We used the sales price, and here again is just an estimate or a forecast, of $250 an acre foot. And those water sales would not be to the JPA, but to an outside party, so that there would be no mitigation water paid for by the JPA. We would continue to make the required contractual payments to the JPA, and then water that's not fallowed would be sold at the ag water rate. So there's 480,000 acre feet in total. According to the current contract, if we sold 160,000 acre feet, we could sell 320,000 to the farmers or the ag community. And so this is the slide that will show the financial impacts of all three of the scenarios. We sold 480,000 acre feet, the revenue to the IID from the JPA would be $61 million. The fallowing cost for the 480,000 acre feet are $72 million. So the net financial impact is a negative $10 million over that 4 years for that mitigation water under the current scenario or estimates. And then we ran this through our model. We ran all three of these scenarios through our model. Okay, and said what's the projected cash balance at the end based on our model, and it was $779 million. So scenario two is we sell the 480,000 acre feet to the ag community, get $20 an acre foot. So we get an additional $9 million. And the impact of that, along with the added interest that we would earn on our cash balances at the end of the contract in 2047, we'd have $806 million, or about $27 million or so better than the base case. And then scenario two is what I think we have in front of the state board now. The revenue from the sale of fallowed water would be $40 million. The incremental ag water sales would be 320,000 acre foot at $20 an acre foot. That's $6.4 million. Figuring the estimated fallowing cost at $24 million. And so the revenue from that fallowed water is $40 million. So the net amount is 16. And the way we have this modeled is that we would contribute that to the JPA, the $16 million, and then we would not contribute to the JPA the incremental ag water sales of $6.4 million. And that scenario gives us about $802 million at the end of the period in 2047. So, my opinion looking at which scenario is best, well, obviously one gives the district the most money at the end of the period. But scenario two is the one that at least I recommend, is because not only does it give the district more money than the current base case, it also increases the monies available for the JPA for mitigation. So it's the JPA wins and the district wins, so to speak, under scenario two when you compare it to the base case.
My understanding on that JPA is some of the other entities pre-funded their obligation, but the IID did not. Is that correct?
That is correct.
So could this count as an early payment into that JPA or no? Or we just keep paying along the way every year?
I think right now we're going to pay according to the schedule.
What's the rate of return that they charge? Because it's present value, correct?
It is a present value payment that we're making, yes. And so
any idea what the discount rate is?
No, I don't know what that is.
Because we're not earning any money on our money, all right?
We're earning 1%. Very little, that's correct.
Okay.
Any other questions for Greg?
Yeah, the upfront that the other water agencies paid, does that fulfill their obligation payment into the JPA?
It is my understanding that it does, but I'll let Bruce Wilcox amplify on that.
Good afternoon, Bruce Wilcox with the IID. Each of the three water agencies pays in annually to the JPA. They make that payment in December. The money you were talking about, that the upfront money was into the Salt and Sea Mitigation Fund, I think.
It's the restoration fund.
Yeah. And the two water agencies made upfront payments. One water agency makes annual payments.
Or annual?
IID is the annual payment, yes.
Yeah, in the QSA, the 133 million was 2003 or 2006 dollars?
$2003. I think it's about 370 million if you annualize it. And this gives me the opportunity, by the way, to make a correction of something I answered to Director Benson last week. And when you asked me when the money ran out, I thought you were talking about the short-term cash flow in the JPA. I don't know when the money runs out exactly for the 370 million. It's in 2030 or thereabouts. We have a shortfall cash flow problem in the JPA and JPA 16-17, which would be fixed if we went with either scenario one or scenario two. Pardon me, scenario two.
So the actual contribution and present value that the IDA is making to the mitigation fund is about $133 million or so.
No, the three water agencies make $133 million.
That was 2003 million. I'm talking about present value.
Oh, that's probably a Greg question. You're talking to an ecologist. I'm not a...
Okay, well, I think that's what it...
I think that's about right. It
ends up being... Whenever the JPA money runs out, all these projects that you've built, who pays the O&M then?
Well, if the JPA money runs out and the state doesn't step up like they're contractually obligated to do, and there's been lots of discussions about whether they actually would or not, at least in theory, you could stop all of those projects. The managed marsh, for instance, you wouldn't have to pay O&M on them. The dust control mitigation, most but not all of the dust control mitigation, there isn't a lot of operation and maintenance cost on. There is some. So the answer is what you didn't stop, if the state didn't come forward and pay, would IID, if they wanted to keep it working, would have to pay for the operation and maintenance.
That's why we're asking for a stay. We're going to try to find a funding source so we don't reach that catastrophic level.
Yeah, I think that idea that you've offered is a great one, and I think we should move forward with something like that, because operation and maintenance of all of this stuff isn't covered completely by anyone. So larger sums of money to spend on mitigation and or restoration sounds like a good idea to me.
Thank you, Bruce.
Mike Morgan, Brawley, California. In fear that Kevin accuses me of berating your staff, I would appreciate questions if you have any. But remember, if you've got to stay in a QSA, you should probably stay the State Water Resources Control Board. What you're doing here on this second scenario, whether it be called the C1 or C2 water, you had two blocks of water the state was supposed to handle for you and sell to Met. The price was the same sales price as today, but on the C2 water, you're taking less money. So if the deal is being renegotiated, and you're doing a prudence review, hopefully to look at the impacts or conflicts of your San Diego-based attorneys, whoever you're selling this 160,000 acre feet to is getting an absolute windfall. Because at your own sales price today, it would be 400 and something. So you're giving the buyer a $32 million price at a $32 million windfall at a cheap price. Now, that's putting in less money into the JPA than it would have been if the state kept up on their obligation. So when Bruce brings up maybe the state has a legal obligation, but they might not fund it, they've already not taken care of two of their obligations, which was to sell the C1 and C2 water to create $200 million for the JPA to use on the Salton Sea. So you're sitting here as they go through the State Water Resource Control Board in the favored scenario, letting the state off of two obligations, which we're not going to cost them very much money, but generate you an area between you and your personal liability of $200 million. Now you're settling for $16 million. It's absolutely off the wrong side of the equation. So again, if you'd ever want to have workshops on these, I'm sure the public would love to kind of understand it, because it seems to be going so fast that it's hard for anyone to try and keep up with it. Thank you.
Greg, one last question. What happens if there's no buyers for that water?
Oh, under scenario two, then if there's not going to be any mitigation water sales, then I would guess it's available for the ag users.
Okay, thank you.
Or to pay back.
Okay, thank you, Greg. Next item, 18, Information, Energy Department General Matters, page 98. Mr. Stills.
Yes, Mr. President. Just to inform the board that the IID Energy has submitted a proposal to the CalISO in response to the policy-driven PTO extending from Ivy Sub to a 230 kV switching station on the north side of the West Side Main, adjacent to the Campo Verde solar project. The proposal encompassed groups across the IID's enterprise, and the effort was led by the PMO, with Walter Gonzalez and Kristen Kirkengard doing a very good job there, as well as the other team members put that proposal together. So we did get that in. We have acknowledgement from CalISO that they have received that. So the proposal for the PPTO is in place. We have also met with Campo Verde, and they have raised the alarm concerning the completion and execution of the Gentai agreement and the encroachment agreement for the crossing of the line. If you remember correctly, you've approved a term sheet for the agreements to be put in place. We still have some legal work to do on that. I've put a priority on that with staff so we can try to get those out so they can meet their completion milestones.
You mentioned an alarm. That's their concern of meeting a date?
Yeah, they're concerned with meeting their completion milestones for their financing. So we're going to have a meeting tomorrow and try to resolve all future or all issues inside IID so we can get that done. So now I'm just teeing that up. That is critical path for us right now. Item three is the California Energy Commission was set to publish negative facts inferring IID was solely responsible for the September 8, 2011 outage. I sent Ms. Asbury and Tony Braun to the CEC Commissioner's meeting last week to voice our concern that the statements were not factual. The CEC did back up on their statements, but Chairman Weissenmuller used the meeting as a bully pulpit to express his concerns that IID was obstructing the renewable effort, even after acknowledging the progress over the last 6 months. Now, we plan to bridge this gap with Chairman Weissenmuller, but we plan to bridge it without compromising IID's BA or its autonomy. So we will be following up on that. That was also picked up by the California Energy Markets and published in their reports out today. So that's an issue that we're looking at.
What was the name of the commission?
Weissenmuller.
He's actually the chair.
The chair.
Mr. Nahai is contacting Weissenmuller's staff to set up a meeting. And my understanding is that Mr. Weissenmuller will be speaking at the annual energy summit next month here in Imperial County.
Yeah, that's correct.
How'd that happen?
I don't think they got the memo.
And we're funding that?
We are.
The fourth issue that I have is I've received a request for assistance to install three light poles at a local high school baseball field. And if I hear no objections from the board, I'll look to see how IID can support this effort. It'll be part of Energy's renewed efforts to extend better customer service to our customers. So if there are any problems with me following up on that, please say so.
Where's the field?
It's Brawley High School's field. But
just
I'm assuming
installing the pole, right?
Pardon?
Installing the pole.
Yeah, installing the poles. They need a digger derrick out there to be able to auger the pole holes out. So we've done this in the past. We've done it many years ago with actually IID crews helping like the Sunbeam Little League fields out there. It's just something that we try to support with our local public or have in the past. So if you're okay with it, I'll try to find a solution for that.
Yes.
Okay. The fifth issue is that I sent out the information on the Cal-ISO Pacific Corps merger last week, and that merger was for the express reason of the Cal-ISO trying to establish an energy imbalance market. The public agencies, well, first of all, even though I plan to push for an optimization of IID's generating assets and to see if we can minimize our single greatest contingency and free up generation to possibly sell into an imbalanced market, we still have some reserves that this EIM market that they're trying to establish with Cal-ISO is an intermediate step towards pushing utilities towards an RTO or regional transmission operator system. I also sent out Mr. Braun's white paper on that for your purview. There are cautions that we really want to follow this issue, and we'll keep you abreast if there are any more developments on this.
The other public utilities that are also balancing authorities, they're expressing the same concern over this?
Yes. I mean, we've already met with a lot of the public utilities. I think Jennifer Goodsell and I went up last November to meet with this, but the issue had went quiet, so we haven't had a follow-up meeting, but after this issue, we will probably have a follow-up meeting with the other utilities.
It's our SCAPA members and the LADWP people, they're on board with this?
Yeah, it's 100% pretty much. The ones that are not part of the Cal-ISO. So SMUD, LADWP, all the big ones that have their own balancing areas.
Are the other SCAPA members, there are SCAPA members that have their own balancing control areas?
Yes.
So they're split on this area of concern.
Actually not. The BAs that are part of Cal-ISO reject the notion that there ought to be a single BA.
Yes, absolutely.
Phyllis at Pasadena is the one that comes to mind to verbalize that.
Item six is, as I told you, we were going to respond to Senators Markley and Waxman's request for cybersecurity information. We did get the information back from APPA, and we have responded to that in the format requested, so we are in compliance with that. And then seven is due to the renewable programs driving interconnection requests from multiple sections in IID Energy. There is a lack of consistent process in standard contracts as we have in the OAT process. So I've directed at all interconnection requests from this point forward, both transmission and distribution, go through Ms. Asbury, and she will work to establish standards, performance contracts, and common processes for others to follow. Eight, a tentative settlement agreement has been reached by PNM and EPA for the San Juan generating plant. The terms agreed to result in a less costly solution that provide broader environmental benefits than the current federal plan. It would lead to the retirement of units 2 and 3 by the year 2017 and the installation of nitrogen oxide reducing technology called selective non-catalytic reduction technology on the remaining two units in early 2016. The ownership issues have not been ferreted out there. There's a lot of work to do. There's multiple steps since this is a tentative agreement, and they're not expecting any type of ratification of this agreement until the end of 2014. So we'll keep you posted as that information becomes available to us.
The IID position there, Carl, has been discussed quite a bit. Now, the capacity on those transmission lines, is that in IID's name, or is that in the facility's name and IID's just a participant?
You know, I have to check that out. As far, I know we have the capacity. As far as whose name is it in, I'll have to look at that issue.
Because they've talked about rebuilding new natural gas-fired plants there. They're not calling them repowers.
I think there's a portion that is not in our name, and I think the rest of the portion comes in on the SWPL. So I'll have to look at what that path is and where the ownership is.
Thank you.
But I'll get that information for you. The other thing that I have is, and I know Mrs. Sierra has requested a look at the Clexco outages down there. I don't have that information with me, but I will look at it. We did have an outage Friday on in Brawley at the Parkview substation tripped. It was balloons on the conductor. They've got that restored. But we do have weather warnings right now that are coming in with winds projected to be above 45 miles per hour. And we're supposed to have some rain. So we've beefed up our line crews and our troubleshooting crews for the standby list so we can be prepared for it.
Thanks, Carl. Any other questions for Carl?
Carl, on the New Mexico, when do we start looking at alternatives to purchase that power?
I think we should be looking at those alternatives right now and start preparing for whatever decision we have to make on it.
Okay.
I think, that's depending who you talk to, 103, 106 megawatts, but were we to get out of there, we should have some type of portfolio plan to be able to see how we're going to replace those units.
And then is there any word out of the on the state level of an increase to the RPS, or is it still quiet?
The last I've heard was that there was legislation pending already in the state to go to 40%. So I suspect we've been hearing rumors of that. I don't know how much traction that's getting, but we keep hearing the rumors, and they are increasing. So I would expect that we might see some legislation on that coming up.
Matt, you didn't hear anything on your trip to Sacramento?
Yeah, we did. We had some discussion about that very issue. Mr. Ortega, are you still here? Could you come to the podium and share the question you posed and to the group and how they answered that?
Yes, again, good afternoon, Antonio Ortega, IID Government Affairs. The question did come up during a policy forum that Director Desert and I attended, and the response that we heard not only from those at that forum, but even at subsequent meetings that we attended and asked the same question, the response was a unanimous, there is not an appetite to do that at this time. No legislation has been introduced, but the deadline is this Friday. So who knows, somebody might introduce a bill, but Assemblymember Bradford, who is the chairman of the Assembly Energy Committee, whom we had a brief opportunity to speak to, and also Assemblymember Perez, again, did mention that it seems that that will not be the case this year, given the potential rate increases to not only the customers of the IOUs, but also the publicly owned utilities.
Antonio, what's the deadline coming up? You just mentioned about submitting bills.
February 22nd, so this Friday is deadline for formal bills to be introduced, and that's when we will really know on the following day what has been introduced or not. But again, we did hear that there wasn't really an appetite to do so this year.
Yep. Thank you, Antonio. Okay, that's all. We'll move on to item 19 under information. Review a letter agreement amendment to Centinela Solar's affected system construction and operating agreement, IID contract number ASA-02, page 99 of your agenda. Mr. Stills.
Yes. Some time ago, you actually approved a affected system agreement with Centinela Solar that had them with a cap of $19 million. It was $18 million for the affected system and $1 million in SOPs that were anticipated because no studies had been done to determine what those flows would be. In December of 2012, we actually ran the first cluster study and completed it for 2,689 megawatts of generation based on criteria COD prior to 2015 and how real of a project they were going to be up there in the CalISO's queue. And the cost estimates for Centinela dropped drastically in that study process. Since then, there have been some requests to revisit that study because the CalISO has cleaned their queue up, and that cost or that base case is going to be re-ran again with a probably a little over 2,000 megawatts. Jamie, is that about 2,030, something like that?
Yes.
Yeah, somewhere in the 2,030 megawatt range. There will be fewer participants because of some projects that are out of the queue, so those numbers are going to go down and then go back up again. But our general calculation of preliminary estimate, we believe that this $6,500,000 cap and $150,000 for SOPs will be sufficient to cover any range of responsibility by Centinela. And so we think it's prudent for us. They're under an obligation by the previous one to put that LOC in place by March 15th of this year. If we do nothing here, if we amend this agreement to drop those caps to the range that we think are there, then that's less expense for the developer. So we're asking that you consider this amendment to that affected system agreement, reducing the amount of the cap for both the affected system portion and the SOPs.
Any questions for Carl on this?
So Carl, just so I understand it, they're dropping from 19 million down to 6.5 cap, but you were thinking it's more like 4.5.
Well, the study that we did when we had the stakeholders, their portion was going to be in the 4.5 range.
Okay.
But the restudy, because there's fewer people and there's fewer, it's going to go down, but it's going to come back up because of fewer people.
Right.
But we think that 6.5 is probably sufficient to cover that. We think that's probably going to be in the 5.6 range rather than the 6.5 range.
Of the 2,099 megawatts, do you have a list of what projects those are, so we know when we're talking to people what's realistic?
We've discussed it publicly. It's the Centinela Solar, AES Solar, 600 megawatts. There's Solar Reserve. There's the Mount Signal Solar projects, the Silver Leaf and Wisteria Tenasca projects, and also the Ivy Solar South and West Tenasca projects. I think I've covered, and Campo Verde. Oh, forgot that one.
So, Jamie, in regards to the AES projects, the 600 megawatts in total, this is the first cluster of solar projects located south of Highway 98. Now, it's my understanding one of those projects is being built at this time, and there's two other projects that have been both permitted and interconnected through with the IID, but they don't have PPAs. How is that affecting your studies on your system impacts if those projects then in turn are not built out?
The ISO has a different methodology than does the IID for what, you know, you're required to post significant sums of cash as you move through the process to move to the next process. And although that is a three-phase project, I think they have to mitigate for a pretty significant portion of those network upgrades, whether they use them or whether they don't. That's my understanding. And there is only a 200 megawatt PPA at this time out of the 600 megawatts.
Thank you.
But one of the criteria that we talked to the CalISO about was not only their whether they were a viable project moving forward, but their in-service date. So they were given the opportunity, if they couldn't meet the 2015 deadline, to push that date out, which would have removed that portion from the study, and they chose not to. So this portion will be attributed to them under that study.
Carl, if more of these projects dropped out, and I think that's probably a fair statement to make that that they will, and the you've lowered the cap down to $6 million and a half. What happens if some of them drop out that exceeds that? What guarantee you have they're going to pay that? Is it a cap, or why not actual costs? Cap or actual costs?
You could do the cap with a true up.
You know, this, at the end of it, I remember when this came through.
Understand.
You know, it was a last-minute deal. We got to get this through. Nobody knew what it was. So we put something out to protect the IID.
Right.
Now we're weak in that position. Maybe $19 million is too high, because at that time, I think we were figuring, well, what if only 800
right.
megawatts go through? So, you know, if we end up with 1,300 or 1,500, and there's already 22% dropped out, I think this number is too low.
This comes down to one criteria, and you've heard me talk about it before. If we use an allocation methodology coupled with a SOP for curtailment out here under certain conditions, then this their cost here is actually going to go down from this point. If we can't get the SOP, and that's the reason we went to the CalISO, and we couldn't get the curtailment, then under those conditions, then we have to require that the element be upgraded. It really comes down to we were looking at either allocation methodology or an upgrade of the element, full upgrade of the elements identified. Now, because of the upgrade and their curtailment, some of the generators are even asking us if we could do a hybrid, because they're looking at their risk issue and saying, could we take like our transformers at Eltra Central Switching Station, which would be a high risk for replacement or an overload, and go ahead and replace those and then do allocation on the rest of it. And I think we're covered in this process with the allocation with the actual overloads that we're seeing.
Are you prepared to take the delta out of your budget if it goes there?
I think the flows that are there would have to come out of our budget, but I'm fairly comfortable that what we've identified is accurate.
Well, we gave up transmission fees. You know, we're short on capital for some of our projects. This afternoon, we're having a rate hearing. And while we're looking at going to the rate payers, we're gambling with this being sufficient. That's it. You know, with 22% dropped out, the $19 million, I could see drop, you know, that was high and 4.5. I just wish there was some type of mechanism in there that whatever the actual cost is, they're going to cover. Because that's what, with a cap of $19 million, they were not going to have to pay that. That was to cover, that was a maximum, or the actual cost. Now we're going the other way. We're taking away the actual costs.
Well, we could amend that and say and put a clause in there that said if the costs exceed this cap, that they'll pick up the excess. They'll have a little bit of a problem with that on their financing, but that would protect IID.
What are the projects that have dropped out that are impacting us?
What's your base case?
Sure. The CalISO offered a one-time opportunity to generators in its interconnection process to downsize. They don't generally do that, but they did in this case. There were a couple of projects that took advantage of that. And one project also was allowed to modify its in-service date, and that's a rather large wind project seeking interconnection to the ISO. It's in Mexico, and it'll cross the border. It's the ESJ Wind Phase 2 project. It's a Sempra project, and that was 400 megawatts out of that total. So it was a pretty significant sum. And the rest of it was just the reduction in proposed generation by existing projects.
Existing projects in our county or our balancing authority?
No, these are projects seeking interconnection to the ISO system. It's their BA, but these are projects that were included in what we refer to as the IID affected system cluster. They were projects impacting us, but not interconnecting to us.
So can we get fees out of them? We don't get fees out of people that aren't connecting to us, right? If they're, wind project, they don't pay us any.
But they pay us for the proportionate share of their impacts.
Okay.
We are also working out a back fee issue and a rate schedule for that. And then if they're in our distribution service territory, they're paying our distribution requirements.
Any other questions for Carl?
Director Hanks, this is the letter of credit that they'd have to put up, right?
The letter of credit would have to be posted by the 15th, which means they have to guarantee that back with the $19 million, which is a cost to the project.
Right. So Centinela approached IID the first of the year and was obviously angling for a smaller number, which in fact is what it ended up being. I wonder, since you know they're already $10 million to the good, if Centinela could be, if there couldn't be some sort of proviso in this LOC agreement that if actual costs do exceed the cap, that the cap would be soft.
I actually talked to them about it. They have a problem with their financing because it's not set. But again, you know, we could even raise the cap if that would make you more comfortable.
Well, could you run a scenario with fewer people? Say if a few, 10%, 20% of the projects.
I've already had that ran with a fewer people. It came out. Oh, you mean look at a probability of how many?
Yeah,
went.
Some of these people still might not come to fruition, right?
Yeah.
They don't have PPAs.
We could run a sensitivity analysis on
this.
I'm
just curious how much more burden there would be.
We could do that.
Mr. Schott, do you have some comments or questions?
Yes, thank you. Bud Schott with LS Power. We just wanted to say that we agree with Mr. Still's assessment and would support the lower cap. We believe even in the worst case scenario that the IID is still protected. So we look forward to you taking this up at the 12th meeting. Thank you.
Can you give us something to take to the bank, Buzz?
Well, I think Mr. Stills is more qualified to do that, to figure that out. But we believe even with the projects that are going forward, you already have Campo Verde, LS Power Centinela, Tenasca, all those in the cluster one are moving forward. So we think the worst case scenario with the contingency still covers the IID.
Well, I can tell you my experience on this board. Have been very good speculators.
Respond to that.
Okay, anything else for Carl? Thank you, Mr. Stills. Next item is information item 20, a review of request for proposal number 943 for engineering studies required under the district's open access transmission tariff. Page 106 of your agenda. Mrs. Asbury.
Good afternoon, Directors. Jamie Asbury, IED Energy Department. IED's open access transmission tariff is the process by which generators achieve interconnection to the IED system or transmission service across the system. And it's also the process that governs or it and contains IED's obligation to cooperate as an affected system in situations like Carl was just discussing where IED's impacted. We have certain timelines in the tariff, certain studies that we're supposed to perform. The purpose of those studies is to determine the impacts caused on the reliability of the grid by proposed generation interconnecting and what the mitigations for those impacts are. There are different types of studies that are performed and that we require outside assistance for. Currently, system planning has three engineers devoted to this process, but their time is divided among other things, operational analysis for the system as a whole. Clearly, we have a lot of renewable resources interconnected here, and we continue to, the number of requests for interconnection continues to grow. The tariff has some pretty stringent timelines that we're required to meet. We do the best we can. So using outside consultants is a way that it allows IED staff to manage the process a little more, with a little more, being a little more mindful to the timelines. We issued RFP 943 to obtain a pool of qualified engineering consultants to support staff in the performing of the required studies and meeting our requirements under the tariff. We received 16 responses to the RFP. We'll let the board know that none of those responses were from local vendors. During the initial evaluation, we realized that because different companies use different nomenclature to identify similar services or similar tasks performed by employees within their companies, we had to do a little bit more digging because an apples-to-apples comparison with the information we received was not possible. How we dealt with that was we developed five generic study plans that addressed similar things that we, or, you know, similar studies that we currently require. It went to all the vendors. We asked them for the time it would take them to perform that study and the dollar value that they would charge the district, and that way we would be able to evaluate based on consistent information. The evaluation protocol was an executive summary, their organization, obviously who their key personnel were, how they proposed to accomplish the work. Cost proposal was given 40 points. Local vendor, there were none, but it was a 5-point preference. Exceptions to the contractual arrangements got 10 points. We recommended award to the top 6 ranked vendors, and those 6 ranked vendors, that information was provided to IID after contract administration received the cost information back. So we didn't rank them. Contract administration provided the ranking for us. We recommended, we reviewed our recommendation with the Oversight Committee on February 7th, and we explained the pricing issue. The Oversight Committee approved us to move forward with a recommendation. And staff recommends award to the following firms: Orion, Mitsubishi, Reliable Power Solutions, S&C Electric Company, Power Engineers, and TRC Solutions. We have a couple of new vendors on here, which we're excited at the prospect of working with them. A couple of old, you know, people that have been around a while. But it's staff's, we'll be bringing it back to you for approval of these service agreement requests at the next board meeting, and I'd be happy to take any questions if the board has any.
Questions for Jamie?
The Oversight Committee, is that the internal or is that the ECAC?
It's the internal.
Okay, so did this go to the ECAC?
It has not. Because we are running out of consultants currently, I wanted to get a pool in place, but we can certainly take it to the ECAC at their next meeting in March.
What is the size of the contracts? I have no understanding of that.
All of these are customer funded. We requested a certain dollar figure, but it's all customer funded. It has to go through the internal approval process. The tariff sets forth the deposit requirements for individualized studies. Mm-hmm. A system impact study is approximately 50. A facility study is approximately 75,000. But customers only pay the actual costs. We refund to them whatever's unused. And for those projects that move forward and into construction, we then apply those funds at their pleasure to the cost of any procurement and construction activity. So we try to economize. But we the reason that they're in there at the value, dollar value that they are is because going back through the approval process frequently is it holds up, you know, our ability to meet our timeline. So we thought we would ask for advance funding. We're required to have a requisition and go through, you know, the work order process. So there's another layer of control internally before any work is awarded to a vendor under these contracts.
Any comments from the audience for Jamie? Thank you. Okay, that takes us to item 21, our last information item, the presentation of major work authorization covering the Soul Orchard 20-megawatt project at Via Road in El Centro.
Good afternoon, directors. It's me again. This is for the major work authorization in support of the interconnection of Soul Orchard's 20-megawatt El Centro PV project. The interconnection agreement for this project is on the agenda for action at today's meeting, and so we were trying to work in advance since the project has a very aggressive in-service date. 20 megawatts, the generation from this project will go to serve IED load and help meet our RPS requirements. They participated in a competitive solicitation process for renewables, and they were successful and chosen. They are seeking interconnection to the IED system via an interconnection configuration known as a TAP to the 92 kV system that's adjacent to, it's at or near the El Centro steam plant, El Centro switching station facilities. Commercial operation is anticipated October 31st, 2013, and that is very aggressive for interconnection of a generating facility. The network upgrades to the IED system total $386,000, and that is system protection, that is relay replacement, and it's upgrading existing infrastructure at the new Imperial substation and the El Centro switching station to accommodate this facility. The interconnection facilities total $2.2 million. Out of that $2.2,386 is network upgrades eligible for reimbursement to the generator via the issuance of transmission rate credits. This developer is not taking transmission service from IED, so it isn't eligible to use those credits, but it is able to assign or transfer them to a third party. This is just the project site, and I thought it might be helpful for the board. If you look up in the right-hand corner, that is what used to be the Bonanza packing facility, and the pink outlined areas are the footprint for this facility.
Does IED own that ground?
IED owns the land, and I believe it's leased to the project developer through a long-term lease that will be for the life of the project. That's my understanding. The project is 100% customer funded in the amount of $2.3 million. That includes the network upgrades. Interconnection costs consist of three parts: their facilities, our facilities to accommodate their facilities, and then anything beyond that is a network upgrade. So there was additional funding available in their OAT process, like I just talked about. Sometimes we allow study deposits to be applied toward procurement and construction. They had approximately $100,000. They've authorized us to use portion of that to the construction of the project, subject to true up. When we know what the total study costs will be, the remainder of those dollars will be transferred over. The remaining study deposit, again, will be applied to the construction portion after we've settled everything. IED is responsible in our scope of work only for a portion of the facilities to interconnect this project, and that is installation and commissioning of the TAP facilities, the breakers and disconnect switches, and we're replacing two existing wood poles. That we also have to do, again, as I mentioned, the relay protection at the El Centro and New Imperial subs, and we have to conduct a relay coordination study. The major work authorization is for the total of the project cost, recognizing that the developer is responsible for funding that. And they've taken the lead for procurement and major construction so that they can meet their aggressive in-service date. And again, this is another matter that will come back to the board at its next meeting for approval. You have any questions?
Any questions for Jamie?
Yeah. I thought they were hooking this pretty much just straight into our system.
They're tapping into the system, right. It's just taps are different than like a loop in and out configuration. That's why they are interconnecting directly to the IED system.
Well, how do they get paid back with rate credits if there's no transmission?
That's how IED, well, they're obligated, well, IID voluntarily gives rate credits for network upgrades, and the relay protection at El Centro Switching Station and New Imperial Substation is a network upgrade because those facilities can be used. It beefs up our system beyond the point of interconnection. A network upgrade, that's how a network upgrade is identified.
Well, are they transferable to another?
They are. You can transfer or assign them to third parties, yes. I don't know what the market is, Director Hanks, for them, but you can. It is allowed under the tariff.
Boy, the water people need to pick up on that one.
Yeah.
Is this project something that the IID would end up buying once the tax credits are paid back, or?
You know what, that's a Berlin question, I think.
It's an option in the PPA.
Is it
so it's already listed in the PPA?
That
the price and everything?
You can't list the price, it has to be market price. It's an option. It is at IID's discretion to market price.
And just so the board's aware, Jeff Brothers and Lars Peter from Soul Orchard are here, and they are the project proponents for this project.
So is that the same method that was used in the Sun Peak, the one in Nyland?
I'm going to let Belen speak to that. It's on the other side of...
Because there's a third one that we've done, right? A PV project within the IID system that IID is buying the power?
Yes. There's 70 megawatts, so there's a total of, I think, 5 PPAs altogether.
Okay.
If I've got them all straight in my head, hold on.
There's 2 in Nyland.
Yeah, there's 2 Sun Peaks. There is going to be the Soul Orchard.
Oh, there's the Brawley.
There's a 10 megawatt of Ormat.
Yeah.
And then
San Diego State Solar
State.
Yeah, that's Ormat more of a going. Community solar. So it matters if we get that all subscribed or not. Yeah. So, but that would be the fifth. So
Heber.
There's a total of Heber's Ormat, 10
Heber's
megawatts.
Okay.
There's the Sun Peak that just went live last year.
That's 23 megawatts.
That's 23 megawatts. And then there's going to be a Sun Peak 2, which is going to come on in 2014, which is another 20 megawatts. Then there's an Ormat 10 megawatts in Heber, which is due the end of this year. And then there's the Soul Orchard, which is over there by the El Centro Generation Station.
That's 20 megawatts.
And that's 20 megawatts.
For 73.
Yes. Now, Soul Orchard also is the one for the SDSU project, which is considered community solar. So what we'll be doing is marketing that to industries that want to be green and see if they want to buy any of that first. And then if anything that's not subscribed, IID would pick up that difference.
And how big is that Brawley? And
the SDSU? Yeah, it's up to 5.
So do all four have the same agreement or a PPA methodology, or they've been different every time in the way
First one was probably a little bit different than the rest of them, but then the last 3 have been the same, except I'm not considering this community solar because it's a little bit different, but the last 3 PPAs, yes, have been pretty much the same.
Okay. Because if the maintenance isn't very big on a solar project, is it something the IID could end up buying, is my question.
Okay, that's your question? Okay, the only one that we have the provision to buy out is in the first Sun Peak. That's the provision. That's the only one that we have that.
And it's still
option
that.
To buy out in year 7, 6 or
okay.
7.
Okay.
Okay, any other questions from the audience? Thank you, Jamie. Thank you, Blynn. Okay, that finishes our information section of the agenda. We're going to be moving into 2 more consent items and then an action section. And we'll take a short 5-10 minute break.